So there's a lot of tools on the market to generate 3D shapes. Feature films, games, animations all use these tools. And the people that operate these tools are highly trained professionals, because essentially what you're doing is you're taking the idea of editing an image in 2D and you're doing this all for a 3D shape. So because of this, the interfaces have become more and more intricate. So the idea of the research here is essentially to go back to the 2D stuff. Right? And what can people do really well? Well, people can draw sketches really well. Even if they're not artists, they can sketch up something really quickly. We have been developing all kinds of tools to design 3D shapes and also edit the 3D shapes only using sketches on a 2D plane. Because essentially what you're working with is either a screen or a mouse, and all of this has X, Y, has two dimensions of input. And you're limited because of that, so you can't grab into the screen. We try to stay very, very simple. So it's just a white screen, the user sketches a silhouette onto the screen, and from that silhouette, the user gets a 3D shape. So it extrudes into the third dimension under certain assumptions of the shape being globally smooth and all kinds of other nice things. It's like a first step, because you're trying to invent information where there essentially is none. Humans lack a video out. We have video in, we have audio in, audio out, we have no video out. Everyone has a mental model of shape. You know exactly what you mean when you see E.T., any kind of like culturally relevant character, yet conveying that to another person who might not have ever seen E.T. or any other movie is insanely difficult. So this is a first step into the direction of giving people that cannot communicate visually with sketches, giving them a way of modeling these things very, very quickly and easily. What happens oftentimes in the research field, also like in the shape modeling and all these other things, is we do dabble, right? We go all kinds of directions with our research and we try things out, and in retrospect one realizes how it worked. So the minimalist game design principle is a principle that we basically came to understand as we were making Osmos. My close friend Eddie Boxerman started the game just with the whole idea of, okay, what would it be like if I needed to eject parts of myself to propel myself and thereby shrink? This is like the basic idea. In the beginning, these motes, the characters, the spheres that you see, were just blue or red. So blue means they're smaller and you can eat them. Red means they're larger, you can't. It was a binary state. So what would happen is, when you click the mouse, you eject a piece of your matter and you move in the opposite direction. And you shrink a little bit. So you'd want to eat something that's blue and you'd click your way to it, and you'd click one time too many, the thing would turn red, you already have so much momentum going into it, and you die. So it became apparent that, okay, we need to, there's some intermediate state, there's a danger state. So we realize, okay, so we have to somehow, like, the thing has to start getting red earlier. So we understand, okay, the user needs to know this because it's clearly frustration. And the sum of all these design decisions along that one, like along these lines, is what leads up to the whole thing being more understandable. But at the same time, the basic principle of just clicking the mouse to eject matter never changes. You don't learn new skills throughout the game other than understanding how the physics and the system work. We won an award at IGF, and the year just went on from there, because then we got selected into PAX 10. We won two awards at Indiecade. So one thing that happened as a result of Osmos, one of the many things, because it was just like this year has been crazy that way, one of the things that happened is that in April we got an email from a father who had played the game with his son. And it was a very warm-hearted email, very nicely written. And essentially what he was saying is that his son loves the game. He pretends plays to be the moat afterward, and he pretends that the sofa pillows are moats, and he wants to absorb them and everything. And then he mentions that his son has autism, right? And that he was very happy, and like how much joy we brought into his house. So if you get those kinds of emails, then all your work you do is justified from here to eternity.